So today we have the privilege again of having three great instructors walking us through our tutorial on Fourier space. So we have Alex Pofelski joining us from BNL. Joao, I can never say your last name right, Joao.
I think it's always the word for Firmino.
Firmino. Firmino is that from Palm, so the Center for Advanced Light. Microscopy, sorry, I butchered that. And Isabel here at the Canadian Center for Electron Microscopy. So the way it'll work today is similar to the other tutorials, but if you haven't joined us before, basically we'll go through just kind of an introduction, a little bit of theory, basic theory. Hi, welcome, take a seat, pop up. Oh yeah, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. We're difficult to find here in the basement. So we'll be starting off just with a little bit of theory to get everyone set up on the right step before moving forward. And we'll be doing two tutorials, similar topics, one on Fiji, so with the GUI interface, and one using a Python notebook. And again, it's going to be a follow along, so feel free to follow along. If you run into any issues at any point, the instructors are here to help. So just raise your hand and we'll help you out, whether you're in person or for those joining us online, shoot me a message in the chat or Q&A and we'll help you out with whatever errors or if you have any questions at all based on what we're talking about at that moment. So just feel free to let us know if you need any help or have any questions. So with that, I will stop talking because I'm just basically the gatekeeper of questions and answers, but lack knowledge. Image processing, so I'll pass it off to whoever's starting the intro.
So I will be starting.
Okay.
So hello everyone. So just before I start, I just would like to ask in the audience that the one that is present, who is familiar already with Jupyter Notebook and coding? Are you or completely not?
Jupyter Notebook or coding?
From a while ago, I've done Python.
Okay.
Probably a little bit. Yeah, I've done Python and MATLAB, but I'm not familiar with ImageGG at all.
Okay, cool.
Okay. No, it's just to so I'm sorry I couldn't be in physically present. So we will do like that in this hybrid mode. Isabel will be there if there is anything you want to go through. So I made what is called a binder, which means that you don't need even have Python installed. And still be working on the Jupyter Notebook. The thing is that this thing can crash sometimes, so we will see how it goes. If you have your own environment, you can follow up, like absolutely, by just downloading what is available in the repository. Just like regarding the packages, like I would ask you just to download the own packages on your own. So there are very common packages, NumPy, Matplotlib, ImageIO, and Scikit-Image. Like that's the one that you're going to be using today. So if you have them already, you can use already your local environment. If not, we can just follow the on the binder. I think it should work, but you know, as I told you, it can crash. Okay.
Is that a little better? Yeah. Sorry, I switched the audio from my laptop to the TV.
Yeah, no problem. Let me know. And stop me if you need it. No problem on that. Like the goal is to be interactive. And also to adapt, like if, for example, you want to try something specific, even at the end of the tutorial, you have your own data set you want to play with, we can also do that.
So Your screen is not sharing.
That's completely okay. I will start now. Okay. I wanted to talk quickly with the audience to know the knowledge before going. So we will go through very, very brief introduction of the Fourier transform and the Fourier space. But the goal is to be very introductory. We're gonna not go absolutely crazy on the math or anything. So this tutorial is designed more to get you inspired in trying to use your own processing methods instead of using black boxes that are available everywhere. So in the Jupyter Notebook will be an environment when you code on your own and you customize the things at the level you want. The Fiji will be already we have a graphical unit interface where they have already some pre-built packages that are already there, but all of them are open source, so you can go inside and check what you are doing. So here we're gonna just talk about the Fourier filtering and deconvolution today. I will take part of the Fourier filtering section. We will do the Jupyter Notebook. tutorial. Then after we'll do a small break, and then we will Joao will go with the deconvolution using Fiji. Let's get started with the Fourier transform. Again, I don't want to go complicated in the math, but what we have just to think about it is that we have a function that starts from real space in whatever the number of dimension that transform you into complex space. And in this kind of seeing, this is the transformation that we think about when we have, for example, the real space, and when we go to reciprocal space, when we go from time domain to frequency domain. So usually this transformation is going from a space that has a certain, you know, a physical parameter, and then after you go to this inverse of the physical parameter, meter, second, inverse second. So why is there any interest in doing that? The interest is that whenever you change space, the representation of the signal can be is completely different and can be in some spaces very easy. So here we have an example of a sine function. So sine is 2pa alpha x, so the with this frequency. So you have this representation in real space. If you take the Fourier transform, you will see that this equation that have some, you know, intricacies that you have to carry over in real space, they can be described as two delta functions. So very simple functions in Fourier space. So if, for example, you want to code or encode this function, it will be way easier to code it, encode it in Fourier space, because you only need to have the information about alpha. While on the other hand, here you will need to carry over all the information. This carries over in multiple dimensions, as I told you. For example, here we have a set of lattice fringes or hologram or something like a periodic function in 2D dimensions. So this will be a 2D sine function. So instead of just having like this single periodicity, we will have like a wave vector that will be carrying this periodicity. And the same thing when you go in Fourier space, this will be represented again as a delta function. So like a single dot in Fourier space. Okay, so that's the interest. And then we're gonna do some mathematical operation in Fourier space. And then after go back in Fourier in real space to then after either filter or, you know, it try to capture the information we are looking for. Oh, here we have an example of a very typical images that we have in scanning transmission electron microscopy. So this is a silicon lattice oriented around the 1 bar 1 0. And so as we are dealing with crystalline material, they are periodic. And so we are when we, for example, take the Fourier transform of these kind of images, you have what you have on the right. And something that looks, you know, discrete with some illuminated area and some dark area all over. And that's very interesting for us. So the way you read the Fourier transform is to look at, so the center will represent the zero frequency. So which would be the background of your image. So any variation in the background will be represented in this area of the Fourier space. But after the higher you go towards the edge, the higher frequency you are here mapping. And here, as you can see, you have a lattice. This lattice has some different periodicities along different direction, different spacing. And all these dots will be related to the spatial arrangement of all the crystalline lattices. So then after we can assign here the reflections, that the crystalline reflections, we call it like that. So just make sure that do not make a confusion between diffraction and Fourier transform. The Fourier transform is just a mathematical operation. The diffraction is the physical interaction of the scattering beam with the crystal lattice. So they are similar, but there are some differences that, you know, cannot make this one-to-one correspondence. So for here today, we're gonna just use the Fourier transform. We're not talking about diffraction at all, with the idea of filtering, you will see. So one thing that I need to here to put the emphasis on is that, as you can see, this signal in Fourier space looks sparse, which means that we are just some isolated contribution of the signal. That makes us, you know, the intuition of saying, oh, maybe I can isolate some of the elements. I can, for example, only look to the 1-1-1 lattice fringes. I can maybe to the 1-1-1-3, whatever lattice fringes I want. And the reason you can do that is because of the Fourier series decomposition. Any function can be decomposed into infinite Fourier series, but a periodic function can be also decomposed into a finite series, in finite Fourier series. So you can decompose any function in the base of cosine and sine. And well, I would prefer to use it like with this exponential type of decomposition. But what is very interesting is that when you do the Fourier transform, then after since we are dealing with cosine and sine, your representation of the data will be a set of delta function that can be separated from each other. And here, what the only thing that is now of interest is the coefficient, that is a complex here number here. But with this coefficient only, you represent the entirety of your data. So you have the example here on the right that is actually from Wikipedia, a very good example. So I'm going to let it through once because it's all you went through. But you will have a periodic functions that have lots of small intricacies. So we will wait for this animation to go over. And these intricacies can be model with different sine functions at different frequencies. So let me just go back yet. So here, this will be, so here they will represent the six first, what you call harmonics here, those blue curves, and you can add them and you will follow the red curve. So then after, if you display it in the, you know, in this little animation, you will see that they can be separated from each other. Each of these sine functions have a different frequency. And in Fourier space, this looks like the blue curve that you have here. And this is here very interesting. You can isolate a certain set of frequency and only look at this and carry over. Okay. So this is the example again of the silicon lattice. So this is something that we will do today. So we will apply the Fourier filtering, one, to denoise, and second, to isolate a certain set of lattice fringes to see, you know, what we can do with them. In this example here, I just put in some colors, some different lattice fringes periodicity. And here you will see that I put some circles around a certain set of reflection in the case where I isolate with the mask those specific frequencies. And then after, you can do the inverse Fourier transform of this isolated mask, and you're going to make appear all these little lattice fringes that are coming from all these different directions. And this is here what we call this Fourier filtering. And if you add up, for example, all these different components, you get something that was very close to the lattice fringes that you had before. And here in this case, we have filtered a little bit the noise at the cost, maybe a little bit of the resolution. In that case, we can discuss about that. But the very interesting thing here is that when you have a sparse function in Fourier space that can be something complicated in real space, you can do the processing in Fourier space and go back to real space and have something that is improved to your needs. Okay, any questions? Because now we're going to start our tutorial.
Any questions here? No? No questions here, Alex. Okay. Let me just double check the chat. If there's any questions online, again, feel free to throw it in the chat or Q&A. I'm not seeing anything, so I think we're good to continue on.
Let's go. Okay, so I'm going to ask you to go. Where is the chat? Into that link. And we're going to try to launch the binder. Okay, now I have to try to find the chat of the Zoom.
Can you?
Where is the chat?
I will just put the chat up here so that when you paste it, you can see.
Oh, here, got it. I got
it. You all have the link open.
So I want to send to. I said.
What are you showing? Okay. All right.
Yeah, that's. This will be this on the top. I would like to talk with Sam. Can you forward the link I just sent in the? I cannot talk with the entire audience.
Oh.
In the chat. That's why.
I will let you do that.
Okay.
I'll do that too.
Okay. And then click on this launch binder icon on the bottom. And let me know how it goes. Here, Isabel, if you could check on the same time, you should come up with something like that.
Yes.
Here, I'll write it up.
Actually, yeah, it should be coming here. Sorry, this one. Let me actually do it with you. We will see how it goes.
Can you
start? So that's the moment. I hope it will work. We will see. It can take some time, so we will wait a bit. Okay, so I'm there. Let me know if you are around that page.
We're gonna go there once you get going. Everyone else good?
Okay, so you go to tutorial file and you launch the image processing tutorial 5, not the solution. The solution is for after. And here we're gonna just execute the first line once you are here. These are just to install the packages in case they were not already present in Binder. If you run it on your local tree, just load the libraries. Don't run this first one. Okay, so I'm gonna show you if you run this first, they should have some things going on. It just we should install. So in that case, you don't need to have any Python install anything, and you can continue. So I will continue on my local build, just in case to avoid any crashing. If you have any problems, we can then have to try to delete afterwards. So let me know once you have those packages installed, and then after you should just load the libraries, and we will. I just want to check that nobody has any error message, and if we are not, we will start.
Good. Okay, Alex, I think we're good to go.
Okay, so we will just execute that line, the matplotlib notebook. This is just for plotting purposes. So nothing like it needs to be done, else the plotting wouldn't work. Okay, so technically we are, you know, you should have followed all the tutorials before, but I know that some of you here are just joining here. So we're gonna just go very rapidly in some early stages of the, which is loading an image and plotting it as a reminder. So to load the image, we use the image.io library that we loaded as IO. So, and we read the image with imread. And here, I think if I recall well, the name of the file that we are using today, it's stemsilicon.si.diff. It should be there. And to plot, so this is here what you use, we call the figure and the axis in matplotlib. And here, then after we're gonna plot on the axis, which will be in the case image show, the image, the image show is very similar to MATLAB. And here we will be calling our data, which will be image size. So one thing to go, if once you start to write a variable that has been already initiated before, if you hit tab, then after you can have them proposed and you can go faster. We choose a color map, we're gonna go grayscale here, and we just execute that. Let me know if you are going into the things. This is just the basic loading of the data. This is the silicon data set. So this is not the same as the one that we saw in the presentation. It's something very similar.
Slow down a bit.
Yeah, no problem. It's okay.
Alex, is it possible to, yeah, and then could you zoom in maybe a little?
Yeah, I'm gonna try. Yes, that's what I was thinking about. Let's go.
There you go. Yeah, that's better.
Very good. No, good suggestion. Very good suggestion. That was, you know.
Everyone's here squinting and I'm like, ah.
No, makes sense. I forgot to do it. Good call.
Alex, does this work in Colab?
Alex, does this work in Colab?
I didn't check that. I didn't check if it's gonna work in Colab. I will suggest to stick into the binder. Is the binder not working? That's what is happening.
No, someone just tried Colab.
Okay, I am not sure. I didn't try it.
There you go. It's scribbled stuff because I had many.
It's fast.
No. I had many buttons, but I had to push it so hard.
I would guess that we will need to import the libraries. I don't know if it's gonna work. How do you run that?
Function that we're using, which is
not good. I don't even know how to run this.
I think it's just boring. No.
Yeah, don't worry about the deprecation.
Yeah, I'm on that. Just read them. Exactly.
It means that if you updated your library, that function would stop working.
I think if you actually scroll down below,
Good?
Yep.
All right.
Okay, so now, once we have this image, we want to look at the Fourier transform. So we will use the NumPy library for that. So let's go NumPy. We can hit tab, you will have all the functions after the tab. So here we're gonna go FFT. Oh, in that case, we need to have a two-dimensional FFT because we are using a two-dimensional array. So we're gonna go FFT, FFT2. And we're gonna go on our image. Okay, and we will plot the results of that thing. So here everything was made ready to go, and we're gonna try to plot the FFT in here. Okay, once you execute, you should see nothing.
Alex, scroll back up.
Absolutely.
Scroll up a little more.
This was it.
Yes, you have a print.
Yeah, it's not.
Necessary. Oh, it's not. Okay.
It's just looking at the data.
No errors minus the one that should be showing up before below your figure.
Below the figure, yeah. You should get an error message. Okay. No, that's
You're
should have this one.
Here.
Mm-hmm. So the reason for that is because we have here a complex number. And the complex number has an additional dimension that is not applicable with this imshow function. So we need then after to adapt because the imshow is looking for a 2D array. So you need to provide him some real numbers. So here you need to either do the absolute value of that Fourier transform, the real or the imaginary part, whatever you want, but you need to just provide the real number. So in that case, this is what we're gonna do. Yeah, we're gonna provide the real thing. Okay. So you should see now a very black output. Do you confirm?
Yeah, we have someone with a very white picture.
It could be white, it could be black or white, whatever, but no error message. So this is again related to your data, because your data is just showing some delta functions at some very isolated value. So you're not able to plot that. Most of your data is actually close to zero. So in that case, you need to change the way the data is displayed. And so we're gonna do a normalization that will be look at the log norm function, okay? And if you do that, then you should have something appearing there. So the other method, instead of doing like this, the normalization function here, you could decide to do a function log 10. After the absolute value, to express your real numbers into log space. This is because you have some very high value and some zeros. Makes this very close to zero. So the data range is so huge that the plotter is not able to plot it properly.
So basically, that's 32 bits.
I don't know exactly the number of bits, but like this is, I think we are in 32, but like that's exactly that. And here you will see with Joao that the advantage of having Fiji will be here, that is all here is taking over by Fiji. You will not have to do these little things.
There's a question. Can you explain what we're looking at right now?
The Fourier transform. This is the Fourier transform of your silicon.
And that's the one in your slide.
Yeah, why does it not look like the one in
exactly.
your slide?
Because here, the Fourier transform, like if you just code it like that, the 0, 0 is located on the top left corner. And the one that I show you is the zero that is centered on the center of the screen. So technically, the Fourier transform should look like that, you see. But for visualization purposes, we will have to shift it. So we're going to create here FFT, click on shift. Okay, it will be a NumPy FFT, FFT shift.
You had typo, okay. Where?
FFT, FFT.
Nice catch. Okay, so we're gonna shift. This shift function will shift from the top left corner to the center. And now, so you execute that again. Instead of showing FFT silicon, you're gonna do the FFT silicon shift. And now you should see something that looks like that. So here you will see a clear disadvantage of using Jupyter Notebook versus Fiji. And you will see this. Because here Fiji will take over everything. They will do the Fourier transform for you. It will show you the absolute or this or the another metric that will be directly visible. And also it will center you the Fourier transform into the center.
Can you just scroll up again, Alex? Just so
absolutely. Yeah. To see line. To check again. Mm-hmm. And those are things that you know needs to be taken care of specifically, because when we're gonna be the try to mask, we're gonna do some mask functions. We want to use these mask functions on the shifted Fourier transform.
Right.
Can you define the shift?
So in that case, the shift is pre-recorded to be on the center of the array. This because this okay. is a function FFT shift. But then technically, you could shift it the way you want. But since it's very common, they made the function to shift it exactly at the center of the array.
That's handy.
Mm-hmm. There is some little handiness on this, this Python scripting. Are we here? Are we good?
There's just one error we're working through.
Mm-hmm.
And we're good.
So we can use those knobs here also if you want, for example, to zoom in and look at specifically here. So that will be our Fourier transform that we looked before with the different reflections represented like with these different dots. And the first exercise will be just we're going to do some denoising. That's going to be relatively simple. Is it okay if I go on?
Yep, we're good.
Okay. So the first idea is to do this denoising. So the noise actually is distributed in the entire Fourier space. But one thing that is interesting when you look at this Fourier space is that most of the signal is located into the lower frequencies. Like all the high frequencies here, there's no signal. This is because we are limited by the resolution of your probe that is not resolving those higher spatial frequencies. So instead of having them in your Fourier, in your image, we can just cut it by masking them out in Fourier space. So we're going to make two types of masks, the Gaussian mask and the circular mask. And we're going to try to cut all these higher frequencies and see if we can improve a little bit our original data that look here. Like it's not too bad, but we can see, for example, you see, there are some little bit of this the scanning noise that we try to remove. We'll not be able to remove all of them because some of the scanning noise are low frequency, but some of the high frequency will be removed. Those low frequency will be more removed in we did that in the image registration tutorial form. Okay, so to do that, we will have to we're gonna code our own mask. Okay, so and here NumPy comes up again very friendly. So we were going to create a 2D grid first that's going to represent our 2D space, okay? Because we need to have like to create our mask in 2D dimension. And there is this function that is called mesh grid here. So we're going to, here we create two arrays, so X and Y, going from 0 to 2048 or 2047. And then we were going to use this function mesh grid, okay? So you should just execute that. And we're going to print. To see how those things looks like. Okay. Let me know if you can see it.
Everybody got it?
So now your XX and YY are now two-dimensional arrays. And as you can see, the X will be the variation from 0 to 2048 along one dimension, exactly like, you know, the same number in each column, while YY will be exactly the same numbers per line. And this way you are creating your 2D dimensional grid. And we're gonna now create our mask as a mathematical operation with this on this mesh grid. So here I put the example on the Gaussian mask. Okay, so here you will have like the, we create a function. Here everything is written. You don't need to do anything. With the different parameters of your Gaussian. So here, the amplitude, the center X, center Y. Actually, I should maybe just go quotient function. Yeah, we're doing with the Wikipedia, just to remember, like, this is what we are looking for. I think in this Wikipedia, we have, yeah, this is what we are trying to code, this function. Actually, sigma x and sigma y will be the same. So we are just trying to make a function that represents exactly this equation. So we are here, center x, center y, sigma would be that the broadening of your Gaussian and the grid on which we apply. And you just basically create the mass by just writing down the equation. You see NumPy exponential, x minus center, y minus center square divided by sigma. Okay, this function returns a mask. And when you put the parameters of your mask, you will get your, you know, the quotient mass. We will do the same now for a circle. Okay, but now I'm going to be asking you to work a little bit. Okay, so here we're going to do exactly the same type of function where we're going to define a radius, a center, and on which grid we apply. Okay, so first we have to initiate our mask circle. So we're going to here first go and create a set of zeros everywhere on the grid. Okay, so you can use, for example, grid X shape. Here we initiate zeros everywhere on the entire thing. And now we're going to define the condition being inside the mask. So this is going to be creating an array of true and false, true corresponding to inside the grid and false being outside of the grid. So what condition would I apply here? Any ideas?
I've heard a logical function. Yeah.
Could you do like the square root of like the sum of x squared and y squared less than the radius you find?
Exactly. You will gonna put the, so instead of putting a root square, I'm gonna just square it. But you're gonna put exactly as you said, a condition. So we're gonna write down our x minus x center. So we're gonna actually write it x minus x center. Center x. Square it. It's the same. Also, it should be grid x. Sorry. You are inside the function. Grid x. So same thing here, grid y. Okay, and now we have to put our condition. So we will put that we are inside the mask. So we're gonna put here smaller than the radius square. And I forgot the square here. Okay, and we're gonna not forget to put like this in the bigger parameters. I don't know if it's needed or not, just in case. Okay, so this is our condition to be inside. And this is here what is great regarding NumPy. Is that we created a set of zeros. And then if you apply this array with this inside condition, so we're just gonna say when you are inside one, here we are creating a mask, we are creating after a function that is only one inside that condition and zero outside. As simple as that. Okay? So then after we have to execute them to be initiated. So for the moment, we just created the function. So we didn't even went through. Now we're gonna execute that function and check how these masks look like. Okay, is it okay? Any questions? So now let's just initiate our circle mask and our Gaussian mask. Okay, so we're gonna decide some parameters. So here on the circle, we have radius, center, and the grid on which we're gonna apply. So we will say, let's put 300 as our pixel. So the center is the center of the array, which will be 1024 by 2024. Our grid, XX and YY. And we're gonna do the same for the Gaussian. We're gonna apply, so for the Gaussian, we have an amplitude here in the beginning that I should have removed actually. So we're gonna put one as an amplitude because we don't need more. Center, the center before, then the same for the sigma, XX, and YY. Okay? And now we will apply this mask. As we are doing here, the application of the mask is just a multiplication of your mask function with the Fourier Fourier transform image, as simple as that. The thing is that we need to apply that on the shifted version, because if you apply it on the not shifted version, we will not match the position of the mass of what you are looking for. Okay, so here, yeah,
could be a silly question. I don't know why, but why we should shift the 300 in the second Gaussian mass?
You can put whatever you want. You want to put 100, put 100. It's another number, actually. Try. This is, so you here, what I'm trying to do is to trying to cut the higher frequencies. So you start from zero from here. 300 pixels would be somewhere here. So we're going to make a mask. Oops, sorry. That we're going to just consider inside, that will just approximately, you know, I'm going to just draw it. We'll just consider only that portion of the Fourier transform. So for the Gaussian, the sigma is kind of the same metric. It's not exactly like in correspondence with the pixel directly. It's 300 pixels, but this is like the 63% of the Gaussian. But you can put here a different number. The idea is that we take something that is relatively large, because we want to keep the inside and cut the outside. For that example, we will adapt. I will keep 300 just because I already run with that number, but you can try with 100. Okay, so let's now apply this mask by just doing the mask circle operation that we multiply with our shifted silicon. Exactly the same. This one here. Now it will be, what is this? Even shift. And here now comes the interest of using Jupyter Notebook. You can create your own masks. You can take whatever shape. So then just depend on your, you know, imagination here. And here we're going to just apply something that might be not common, is to say we're going to just make a combination of the mask and the Gaussian. So some of the packages we could have this already, but here you can just go and invent your thing. So we can do mask circle, mask Gaussian, and 50 shift. Okay, and we're going to execute that. And hopefully no error message.
Oh, my bad. Sorry. Sorry, Alex. I'm popping stuff up above you. We're good. I'm like, where did it go on my own screen?
Yeah, so if you are already here, then after that, on the next slide, I just wrote the plotting function, like, because we don't want to spend too much time in just, you know, typing the plotting elements. But now we're going to just be looking at the results of our masks. Okay. So just one note here. I added like this clip equal true. So this little thing is that when you apply your log normalization, if you have zero, you the log of zero, like the if you go to negative numbers, then after you will have problems in the display of it. So the clipping is just putting a dark background over for negative numbers that doesn't exist in log. Okay, so let's run that and let me know if you are at that stage.
Right, just hold on a minute, Alex.
Absolutely. So maybe the Gaussian mask was a bit large. We could have put a lower number now that I look at it.
Sorry, mask both phase and amplitude, right?
Did you hear that question?
No.
You apply mask on both real and imaginary part, right?
So you apply on the entire Fourier transform, exactly. So it's, yeah, you just multiply with it. So this is very important, actually, because you here we are just multiplying by, so the mask will be zero once, so relatively basic. But you have to be sure that whenever you are doing a process with your Fourier space, that the one that you are doing is the one that you are looking for. It's very easy to create some artifacts in Fourier space when you do this type of operation. But we do it on the Fourier image directly here. Yeah. Are we good? Do we see all this?
Just hang on a sec.
Absolutely, no problem.
Is everybody good?
Yeah.
Yeah, all right, we're good to go.
So just to, because there was a question asked, like if I just reduce here to 100 and just execute again, the same thing. Now I should have exactly the same Gaussian mask, but with a smaller size. So here the clipping doesn't work that well. So then after this, some adjustments to put in the display. But the idea is that then after, if you change the radius, you will just change the thing. For example, if we just change here to, I don't know, maybe 50, something extreme. Let's go, let's see how it looks like. You will cut it to something smaller. So basically, yeah, so here you decide. So I'm gonna keep 300 for the moment and we will execute. So now we have masked our Fourier space. Now we need to inverse the Fourier space and come back to real space. But we have to not forget that we did that on the shifted version of the Fourier space. So we need now first to invert the shift first and then do the inverse Fourier transform. Okay, so we're gonna just here do the FFT, and we're gonna say IFFT, IFT, IFT shift. So I will be invert of, now we need to use our the variable that we use to our FFT mask circle directly. Okay, and on that one, you're gonna apply your NP FFT, IFFT2. Inverse Fourier transform of the inverse shifted version. Okay, and we're gonna apply that to all of cases. You just adapt here, mask Gaussian, and now our mask Gaussian circle. Forget to shift back. And you apply. And then we will just visualize the results. So let me know if we are all going there. Also online, if you have any questions, let me know. I'm gonna unzoom a bit just to have the four quadrants. Are we good?
Almost.
Absolutely, Arjun. So you talk about the inverse Fourier transform. I can explain it again. So first, you take your mask Fourier transform, which is this variable, for example, the FFT SI mask circle.
Yeah,
you first apply the invert shift, which is the numpy.fft.iFFT shift. So this one will shift back into the zero corner on the top left corner, the one that we saw initially. Because when we want to do the invert of the Fourier transform, you need to have the original Fourier transform here. And then after you do apply the NumPy FFT, IFFT, inverse FFT2, which is because we have a 2D array. And in that case, you come back to the real space.
So does
that answer your question, Arjun?
You don't?
Got it. Okay, great. We're just still working on it here, Alex, so just give us
no problem. Are we all ready for the visualization?
Are we good? Everyone here got it? One sec. It's just taking time.
It's okay. That's exactly why we are doing this.
Yeah.
We're good.
Yeah?
Yeah.
So now we'll just execute the visualization. Again, this is just the plotting. And we will look at the data. So you have this here, two knobs that you can use. This arrows is to move the image, and this one is to zoom or unzoom in the image, magnify. So we will zoom just like you drag and create a rectangle just to zoom a little bit more in your image. So it will comment what we have here. Okay. So the raw data on the top left, the filter circular mask on the top right, the Gaussian mask on the bottom left, and our combined mask. So just basically what you can see here is that we managed to remove the high frequency noise. So it looks now you have all these little variations that are now removed. But you can see here that you still have some contrast a little bit in between. That is very typical when you use a circular mask that has a sharp edge. If you use the Gaussian mask here, so which also filter a bit the Fourier space, here everything seems to be a little bit smoother, but you see a little bit of blurring. And this is the cause of, because the Gaussian function is not sharp enough actually around your frequency edge, is including all this high frequency edge. And if you look at this combined version, you have the kind of a compromise between the two Gaussian and circle. So you have the circular mass, which is slightly, you know, this edge is slightly less sharp and give you this version, like slightly denoised version. That then after you can use for either your data analysis or for your figure. And you can now move it to see like the different area. Okay? And that's a simple Fourier filtering. And now I just want to make a try. If I don't do the shift back, just to see what type of error we will get. That's actually an interesting question. So let's play this one.
Someone here knows.
Okay, so what do we get here? Oh, and I forgot to mention that here to look at the image directly after the inverse Fourier transform, very important. So technically your image should be real. You shouldn't have any problem. The thing is that when you code it, like the inverse Fourier transform brings you back into complex space. And that's because you have always some little, like you don't have a perfect symmetry or perfect zeros. So always when you come back, you have a complex number. So you need to take the absolute value or whatever, or the real, in this case, the real space, if you want to image it with image show. So that's the difference between analytical and then after when you code. So in that case, do we have actually anything inside or is it just blank gray? Okay, looks completely gray. Oh, no, there is some features inside, no? Ah, we see some stuff. Interesting. So this is probably you are masking a complete different part of the Fourier space. Like the inverse Fourier transform the inverse Fourier transform is not have a matching correspondence with the frequency and is absolutely lost. I don't know exactly why he's doing this. That's interesting. That's interesting. We'll have to, you know.
Did you hear Isabel's explanation?
What did you get? Sorry?
Isabel said you might be only getting the high frequency components.
But the thing is that we masked the shifted version. This is here removed. So we still cut the good portion of the Fourier transform. So this is here the inverse Fourier transform that is applied on not the properly centered Fourier transform. So I don't think it's necessarily related to only the high frequency. I think there is something just, I don't know exactly how, if you forgot to shift an aspect, how does it translate? In my opinion, it's just an unmatching of the frequency. But you know, this needs to be investigated more. Okay, so it was shift. Go back to something. Okay, any questions? So if not, we can go then to the other subsection. So I see that like depending on the time, I may stop a bit early, like just to be sure that we have enough time to do the Fiji deconvolution. So I think we can still cover a little bit, but then like, you know, if you have not enough time, I will just go through the end of the solution quickly just to show you, but we might be still on time. So now what we want to do is to use what we saw before in this PowerPoint. We're going to apply exactly what we did before, but instead of putting the mask to cut the high frequencies, we're going to put the mask just to isolate a certain crystal reflections. So here we can just execute the first lines here just to see how it looks like. Okay, and I'm going to present you what you are looking at. So you just execute them. It's all written. Okay?
Yep.
So now we are looking to an indium phosphide 111 substrate on which has been grown a buffer layer of indium gallium arsenide. In that case, if you zoom in a little bit in that sample, you will see that the atomic arrangement is changing. There are some modification here. So here, what we call a micro twin. You might see even like some dislocation, some stacking faults errors, and so on. Okay, so there are stuff happening in this sample. Okay, if you look at the Fourier space on the right, okay, it looks like that we have a classic Fourier space with the different lattice frequencies, okay? So in here we have the zero frequency. Here we have what we call the 1-1-1 frequency. Here laterally these are the 2-4. We don't need to know all the reflections together. But what is here interesting, if I just get to the center, is that we have here 0-1-1-1, but here we have like some double peaks here that are kind of separated. That these two, this one is not supposed to happen. You should have only this one, and this one. In this specific row. So what we're going to try to do, we're going to try to isolate that reflection, and that reflection, and see what is there inside. See what we can say about it. Okay? So we will not do all of them individually because it's going to take time. We're going to just apply it just on the 1-1-1. Okay? And we will just apply it on some presets that I have already put inside. So now we want to isolate the 1-1-1, so which will be this reflection here. We're gonna use the mask circle that we just created before. And instead of putting a big radius, we're gonna make a small radius. And instead of going at the center of the image, we're gonna go to the center of the reflection. So if we just go on the center here, that is, you can read the coordinates on the bottom right of your image. You can see it here. You can look at here. So you have 10,028,834. Okay, that will be your center. So we will just apply the circle function that we just made it before. And we're gonna put, so here with the radius. So if you look at the number of pixels around, this is 20 pixels. So we can imagine that from the center to here, like 30 pixels seems to be reasonable. So you put 30 pixels. We're gonna now put our value of the center, and the same with the grid. Okay. And we execute exactly the same thing as we did before. We're going to apply this mask. So we're going to just make mask circle 1-1-1 that we multiply. Now we should have the FFT indium phosphide shifted. Okay. Same thing as before with silicon. We need to shift your Fourier transform. But now you just apply it on the indium phosphide. Execute and you just watch what is there. It wants to show it. Oh, what did I do? Oh, sorry. There is an error here. This should be subtract. So there is an error in my notebook. You will have to change manually. Is it okay?
Are we good? Everyone fix it?
You should be able to see your Fourier space now. And now, as you can see, we isolated just that little reflection with our circular mask. And the same as what we did before, we're gonna do the inverse Fourier transform to see the lattice fringes associated to the 1-1-1. So to save some time here, I just pre-registered some other masks on some other reflection. Okay, so we're gonna just execute them. Okay, exactly the same principle as what we did with the 1-1-1. When I add the 1-1-bar-1 and the 0-2 into the game. So just execute that and just run the visualization. And you should see something like that. So in the next steps, they were just pre-written. It's doing exactly the same process as what we did before, but just including the other reflections that we would like to see. The 1-1-1 is the one that just we call it together. The other one are just had been added.
We have that.
Yeah.
We're good.
There might be a mistake. Maybe 0-2 and not 0-2 bar. I will have to double check. But this is minor. Okay. So now we want to visualize the lattice fringe. Okay, so we have to do this invert Fourier transform as we did before. And here we have a little bit of more work because like the exactly as we did before, we shift the back and we do the inverse Fourier transform. Okay, so I like doing it. I like shifted before because just to be sure that I am doing this thing correctly, then I'm gonna look for my, so this one from the 1-1-1. So FFT mask circle 1-1-1. Up. And then I apply the inverse Fourier transform. before. So you could for sure apply the inverse Fourier transform before of the fifth, but I feel that for the purpose of showing, you show that what is inside first of the parenthesis and then go.
Just a second.
Absolutely. Is it good?
I think I don't know. I didn't
get any picture. There's no errors, so we're good.
Sometimes sometimes some things can show no errors and still not be good. So we will see after. So here again, pre-written, you inverse the Fourier transform for each individual reflection we have isolated, and we're going to just plot the Fourier image. And we're going to comment that. Let me know if you come to this plot.
Is everyone seeing that?
Yeah, like winning the lottery.
Yeah. Equivalent to winning the lottery, I've heard.
To make it work? Okay.
No errors.
So in this data here that you have, I just focus here the image on the twin. So here you can see, so if you don't know what's going on, you can, for example, isolate the reflections on your own and trying. Oh, so the 111 A bar is not correct from what I see. And this is what is happening in the 111 A bar. Okay. Oh my God, I did another mistake. But here, I should have asked you for the 1-1. Okay, so sorry. Here we have to, I don't know what I did this. This should be 1-1-1, not a bar.
Is everyone seeing this correction?
Yeah. That is not good. Okay.
Go up to the original one, Alex.
You just have to change the name to the 1-1-1. We did the, so I didn't read correctly. Like I went too fast. I actually asked to do the 111A and the 111 bar A, but that's okay. We just isolated the 111. That's fine. We're gonna just make the small correction here. So I'm just checking that we have the proper three. So this is good, and we just have here to change to the bar two. Some little corrections like that, and this will not. Call it AB bar one. So you just had inverted 111 and 111 bar one, basically. So we have to re-execute those elements and show it again. And now it makes sense.
Yeah. Did you all catch the changes?
My apologies.
Change some stuff.
Everyone online catch that? If not, let us know.
So it's not important, it's just an inversion of the variables. So each one should match exactly the name of each reflection.
Alex, can you just go back up?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, this can happen when coding, like a typo. Is it okay?
Almost. One sec.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, just the one. Yeah, we're good.
So you should get this set of lattice fringes now. And so on the left, you have the top left, you have the raw image. And on each quadrants, like each element, you have like some different reflection. And so when you don't know what's going on, you can try to see at the Fourier filtered image to give an idea. So for example, if you look at the 111, the 111 represents the lattice fringes that are along the vertical direction. They are absolutely not disturbed by the thing that is changing in your raw image. So you know that the change that is happening is not happening along that reflection. If you look, for example, to the 11 bar here, you will see that there are two regions that seems to be dissociated from each other. One is appearing on the top side, the other one on the bottom side. So this is indicating that maybe we have two different families that they are separated from each other, and that we needs to be, you know, carried over differently. And if you look at the 002, you will see that they appear on the bottom, not strongly at the top. But then after you can also move your image to another area. So here I go a little bit more down by dragging. This can be a bit slow. Oh, okay, for example, this can be a good one. So on the bottom, we have the substrate, and you can see that the 002 shows up very clearly now. And if you go fully down, you can see that here we have like some, you know, more congested area. There is actually some dislocation, partial dislocations here. What is going to be happening is that in your fringes, you will see that some splits get zigzaggy, and in some of them, you might even see that there are some missing planes. This is the way, then after we try to identify where the dislocation are, and then after once you have identified them, you do your Burgers vector and you try to characterize them. So in that presentation in here, you look at those individual lattice fringes. Just for the last element, I am here proposing to make a combination of these lattice fringes to help you visualize some element. This will be like our last coding element. So it's going to be then after we end the tutorial. So here, what I suggest here is let's, for example, make a combination between those two, the 111 bars A and B, to see if we have something that can show. So we're gonna go empty real. Okay, it's because we can take the real image part of this, and we're gonna take this one, for example, the 111 bar 1A, and we do plus the other one. And that's again here the Jupyter notebook comes here when you can customize, you can decide, you can add, you can remove, you can custom the way you want. And I'm gonna just put three suggestions. You can put some different if you want to. On the other one, I will suggest to take the 111 bar, so this one already, but now we're gonna add it with the O2B. So NumPy real image filtered O2B, for example. And the last one, we're gonna make a combination of this previous one, and we're gonna even add the 111. That's NumPy real of the image filtered 111 set. Okay.
Isabel suggesting to check your brackets.
True. In this one, yes. Boom. That was true. I think I'm good now. We're gonna execute. If I have an error message, I have an error message.
CMAP. The last
good
CMAP.
Catch. Good catch. Damn. Good eye. Okay. Let me know once you have this.
Can you scroll up?
Mm-hmm.
Perfect.
Idea here is that you combine the different lattice fringes. So in this one, we combine the two from the that we identify from the same family. This one is combining with the other one from the other family. And this one is just combining the three elements.
So you want to just describe what you're doing again, Alex?
Yep. So the idea was that after that we have isolated each of the individual reflections, for purpose of visualization, I just suggest that we could, for example, take some combination of those lattice fringes to, for example, look at how the atomic arrangement is done. So you could do it directly on the image, like if you want to, but sometimes when it's noisy, or where you have like some complicated structure, when you isolate them with lattice fringes, sometimes it's easier to detect them. Uh-huh. So in that case, since we saw that there were some lattice fringes from different families showing in different areas, we're gonna combine them together. So combine, for example, these 111s with these 111s. If we combine both of them, we should have the information from both sides. Okay. If, for example, you combine this one with this one, you will have also the combination from these two areas. But here you can see that the lattice fringes are different here. So they are non-collinear. And when you have something that is non-collinear like that, sometimes some good information is showing up. And the last one is just combining these three together. This way we include also the vertical directions.
Okay.
So these are the, but you could do whatever you want. Like it's here, whatever you prefer.
I'm sure it's supposed to end there.
Is it good?
Is everyone getting it, or are we getting some errors?
I think it's just syntax.
Just can you leave it up for a minute just to make sure everyone?
Well, that's the one. So maybe I have to unzoom once just to have the entire line showing up. Maybe not. Can have the entire line. There is CMAP equal gray at the end.
Difference,
okay, let me actually show it like that, because I think on the left we all know.
Does everyone have it? All right, I think we're good, Alex.
Okay. So once we have that, we can then have to look at the image. And again, I suggest, so this is going to be maybe a bit difficult just to go. So, okay, I will have to, you will have to make a guess, but somewhere around here. Okay. So, because I know exactly what I'm looking at here, so it makes this thing easy. But for example, here it was your raw image. This is the combination of the two 111s. And actually, you can see that there are some, you see the splitting here that is happening. There are some suggestions telling you that there are some missing planes, indication of some potential dislocation around here. If you take, for example, the combination between the 002 and the 111, actually, this is the one that gives you the most information, because here you can see you have here a missing plane, another missing plane here, another missing plane here, and you have the variation of the all the different problem of the stacking points. And then after you can then after use this image to identify them in your real image. And if you look at here in this dark area, yes, we have here a missing plane. Here you get another missing plane. So sometimes looking at the direct image is not that obvious because you know it's noisy and you know the contrast is changing a bit. And those are much more apparent in the Fourier filtered image. So what is good is to combine them to both together, use the Fourier filter image to identify the points where you know your field, there are some abrupt changes of periodicities. And then after, come back to your raw data, then after to do some more quantitative analysis. So for example, in that case, what will be interesting to do is maybe to focus here. So okay, maybe I focus too much because we don't see it anymore. But then after, we what try to do is to do like a Burgers vector. So you do your Burgers circuit, and then what is missing will be your Burgers vector. It will be the projection of like the crystalline defect that you are seeing here. That will be one thing that you can be using from there. And just like to end like the tutorial, I just wanted to mention that since we separated in frequency in Fourier space, you can use this separation and after to combine the data in any way you want. So this is just, you can just execute those two little lines at the end. Something that is relatively complicated to do in real space is very easy to do in Fourier space. And if you look at the image right now that has been here, different lattice fringes has been just put in different channel RGB of an image. Here you have a normalization because you need to have the data between 0 and 1. So this is just a normalization to have this. And you will see that there is this green here, this is actually a micro twin, that you can here completely map and show it very easy by just having masked this in Fourier space that is dissociating from the two area that you have here. And if you zoom in more, like then after you can do visualization of where the areas are showing some certain arrangement of the lattice fringes, then after focus maybe more on some defects and so on. But then since you have separated them, then after you can do combine them the way you want. And in that case, you will see that the blue lines correspond to this, you know, vertical arrangement of the vertical packing. And all along the which is actually the property of the growth, they are not perturbed at all. And you will see that only the lateral fringes are changing. So that's it. That was for the introduction to Fourier filtering. It was like very simple with the idea of, you know, make it very approachable. Of course, then after you can complexify more. I just want to point before ending that be careful also of the Fourier space, Fourier filtering, because it also can bring some artifacts. I didn't went into the detail on that. So it's always good to have to compare your Fourier filter to the original image. Because sometimes you can make appear some stuff in Fourier space, like in your Fourier filtered image that is not present in the real space image. And that's it. If you have any questions.
Okay, are there any questions? Not seeing any online. Are you good for a quick 10-minute break?
Yeah.
Yes, I'd like to download some things. I'd like to download some things.
Okay. Do you want to do that now before the break? Okay. So thank you, Alex. That was great. Mm-hmm. No questions have come up. I think we got them all addressed during the presentation. So for everyone following along online and for those here, we're going to download a couple of things for the next part.
People can hear me?
Yeah. Yep.
Like at home? Oh. Exactly. But we cannot hear Alex.
I'm not important anymore.
Oh, I think you're muted. That's why.
Oh, okay, muted.
No, I'm not.
Sorry, your speaker isn't on.
Oh shoot, my bad.
That's okay.
Okay, we're good. Sorry, guys, for this.
It's okay.
So I just want to make sure that we got everything on track because we're going to be using data sets and might as well download them now. So for the people here in the physically present, we are going to go to open the internet browser. So also for people at home, please open your internet browser.
Are you sharing your screen or not?
One second. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, I'm not. Sorry. People can really see. Got it. So you can see. Okay. So people can all see back.
We see. The Zoom. Yeah, we see.
So we are going to go to Google. We're going to Google any other browser or any other engine that you prefer. Look for the convolution lab. And then you're going to go through 3D convolution microscopy. So this is the plugin that we're going to be using in Fiji today for the convolution purposes. But they have some nice data sets that I want you guys to download directly from them. So once you reach their basic page, which explains how the different plugins that they developed for Fiji work, we're going to go for 3D reference data sets. And here I'm going to ask you guys to download the boring single fluorescence beep. So we're going to click on this guy and we're going to then download this zip file, which is the data set itself. And then we're going to download the point spread function of that, of the beep. We're going to talk about this afterwards. Don't worry, I'm going to explain what these things mean. So far, so good. People are following. Am I going too fast? I tend to go a bit fast. So over here, people are okay. Everything's okay here. Back home, no complaints. And if we are interested, one thing that would be also cool to look at would be, because this is a bit boring, just a bit, nothing really exciting, would be to then go to the C. elegans embryo and download the different zip files here. So the data sets for the different channels and then the PSFs for each individual channel. So because these are big files, they are going to take some time. So that's why I want to do it now before we go on the break. The C. elegans embryo.
Yeah, I'm here. I'm in.
So then you can see these different zip files here.
All three files?
All six files. We're always going to need the data set and the PSF for each individual file. Okay. So because these are big files, I want you to download them before we go on break. So then when we can start fresh. And I think we can stop here because I want to explain how to install the plugin afterwards once we start the session on deconvolution. Okay. So if everyone follows these instructions, you're going to download these files. Go get a coffee, a tea, whatever you prefer, make a break. And then we gather here in, let's say, 10 minutes or 10 minutes. We can be done in 10 minutes.
Sounds okay. Okay. Thank you.
There's something in chat. Let me just see. Oh, that's you.
Gotcha.
Okay. See you guys. Okay, we're back. Hope everyone had a good time. Oh, time off. Time out, yeah. So I'm supposed to talk about the convolution, but before we start, I just want to do a bit of a recap of Fourier filtering space in Fiji, because we can also do Fourier transformations in Fiji, and it might be a bit easier than having to type all the code that we just did with Alex. There's still some limitations that you cannot do with Fiji compared to the NUMPI, but again, just to give you guys an idea how easy or accessible this can be, it's very simple. So I opened the file set that Alex was using before in his Jupyter Notebook session. And I opened the image in Fiji. So basically, I just drag and drop that image. And then what I did was, if we go to process, you'll see here that we have FFTs, right? This is the Fourier transforms that you can apply. And I can apply directly an FFT. Oh, actually, people can see this. Actually, let me just remove that. Sorry. My apologies. So we go to FFT. And then I say, I want to now do a Fourier transform of this image. And when I click on it, I immediately get the file that we were working with before in a much more accessible way. And now I could apply the filters that we applied before. So we can do a Gaussian blur if we want. We can also go to filters here. There are many things that you can do to this Fourier filled image and then reapply it afterwards to get the original image. This is just a quick thing. We're not going to be focusing on this because I'm not going to talk about Fourier filtering. This has been done by Alex very nicely. But I just want to give you guys an idea how we can do this in Fiji using the user interface. Okay.
Can I just make a comment on that quickly? If you can hear me. So just to say here that the great point of using Fiji, everything is pre-built and it goes fast. So for a faster visualization, or you want to filter quickly, isolate some masks, I will highly recommend to start with Fiji and to analyze your data like that. Then after, if you want something fine or something custom, because for example, you don't want the Gaussian blurring, you want the Lorentzian, or you want to create your own function, this is the moment when you would start, okay, do I want to use maybe the Jupyter Notebook interface to go to a little bit more custom or not? So I would really suggest that whenever Fiji is not able to do it easily, then after to start with your Jupyter Notebook. But if Fiji can do it, go to Fiji first.
Okay, thanks for the support, Alex. That's really appreciated. Okay, so I'm gonna pick up on the presentation that Alex was doing before. So I think you finished here, right, Alex?
If I'm I finished. That's okay. I put the new version of the slide. That's okay. You can continue from there.
Oh, yeah. I'm sorry about that.
No worries. No worries. It's okay. It's the same thing for you.
So people can see the. Okay. Can people see the? No, people are. I need to swap, right?
Yeah, you need to swap. Yeah, good.
Okay, so for the people here, you can see, I mean, I have no notes, but basically, we're gonna be talking about deconvolution. So, has everyone here used a light microscope before, or are you only using EM systems? EM mostly, no light. EM also, EM?
You're
not using anything. You're just gonna get the knowledge, got it. Aiden, EM mostly? Okay, so for you guys, this might not be so interesting, but I mean, in the light microscope, one thing that we always talk about is about resolution, right? And we always identify the diffraction barrier. And I could read this description of what resolution is, but basically one thing that you have to understand Ernst Abbe's law, which is the distance between two points in an optical system is determined by the wavelength that you're using to excite your fluorophores. And because we're using objectives, which depend on glass and optics, this is depending on the numerical aperture of the objective. So the higher DNA of your objective, usually you get the more resolution. That's a classical thing that we always teach our users here at COM, at the Center for Light Microscopy. But again, you're always limited by the diffraction barrier of light. You cannot go beyond a certain limit because light starts to diffract if you go really, really deep into the details. But overall, the diffraction barrier for optical systems for light microscopes is around 250 nanometers. You cannot go beyond that. At least using normal techniques, which involve glass and everything. There are super resolution techniques, but that's not the point of this today. We're going to focusing only on resolution and what deconvolution is applied for. I see there are some questions in chat. Let me just quickly check.
Oh, it's Alex.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, I'm just commenting that what you say is absolutely applicable for electron microscopy.
Yeah.
This is the same thing. And the deconvolution idea, the concepts are fully transposable.
Yes, 100%. And Arjun, who is online, is saying they use light microscope a lot.
You like what, sorry?
Arjun is online. Raha is saying they use a light microscope.
Oh, that's fantastic. That's good. So in a microscope, how do we obtain an image? So let's imagine that we have a very small object, which is below the diffraction limit of light. Let's say we are looking at the bead, which in this case is this very small dot here. For people, I'm actually showing people here at physically present that top left object. That's the object we want to see. And this is sub diffraction limited. So it's basically beyond the diffraction limit of light. So when you put this object under the microscope, the lenses of the objective are not really going to be able to recapitulate exactly this object because of what we said before, diffraction of light. What they create instead is a PSF, which is the point spread function. So if I would start imaging this bead, which is a 3D object, a spherical, a sphere basically, and I start imaging from the top to the bottom. So if I start imaging from the top plane to the bottom plane, I would obtain a pattern. And when you actually plot the orthogonal projection of this, which is something that we discussed in previous tutorials. So basically, if I now look at this Z plane imaging from the side, I'll get something like a PSF, which does not resemble at all what a sphere should look like, right? This is very elliptical, it's not very really round, but that's because of the, as we said before, the diffraction limit of light. We cannot go beyond that and we create this PSF. So when you're acquiring an image in the microscope, what you're doing is that you're combining your objects, you're applying it to the PSF, and you're then applying convolution on those two objects, which in the end creates this image, which we can see after that little X. This is your final image. So when I combine these two things, I obtain, instead of obtaining a nice sphere, I obtain this, we call this a flying squirrel object, where in the center we see there's like, there's more intensity, there's where our signal is, but it's not completely round or anything. But this is because limitations of optics and everything. And because we're dealing with light, and again, in the biological sample, usually we have multiple fluorophores, we also have to apply a bit of noise into that, right? So the noise is what creates then this little speckles that we see on the final result of our image. So when you go to the light microscope and you take an image, you always get a bit of noise because of the way you detect the light. And also you have to forget, you have to remember that you're using a PSF that you apply on your each pixel, which creates this kind of image. Okay, so what's the purpose of deconvolution? So let's pretend now that, I mean, I know how, when we're doing with beads, I know how my object should look like, right? I know the diameter, I know the radius, I know how the object, the real object should look like. And I know that my final object is this. So what we're trying to do is actually doing the inverse. We're basically gonna acquire our PSF of our light that we're using to excite this object. We're gonna acquire PSF. We're gonna acquire our images that we usually acquire. And then we're gonna try to recapitulate the object that you can see on the top left corner. So if I move along, so this is what I wanted to explain before, but I just decided to do it manually. So this is what I explained before. If you start acquiring this little sphere from the top to the bottom, which you can see on those little, with the little numbers. So these are the different Z planes as you went through the object. You see that you start seeing towards around 97, the 97 point, that you start seeing like a really nice circle. And then you start seeing different radii, which is the air disk, which I'm not going to talk about. And then when I recapitulate all this volume, which is basically what you can see there on the image that has the Z, this one over here. Oh, you don't see the mouse. Basically, the little extended one where you see like the elliptical surface. This is your PSF, right, of your object. So if I know how my object should look like, and I have this PSF, I theoretically could find an algorithm, a deconvolution algorithm that I can apply to my image and yet recapitulate the original object, theoretically, right? That's the idea that we want to try to implement when you do deconvolution. And as you can imagine, this is going to increase your Z resolution, mostly your Z resolution, and not so much the XY. So this is, I put this slide in because I want to talk about the diffraction, but honestly, that doesn't really make much sense. But what you have to understand is that if you think of waves, when they go through a small slit, through a small opening, a pinhole or anything like that, like we have in the microscopes, you start seeing these different waves. And when you have multiple light sources, when you have multiple fluorophores, they can interfere with one another. And this is why we create like this typical noise that we can find in the objects, in the biological sample. And there's nothing we can do about that. Because I mean, if you are shining light into your sample and you're getting fluorescence from different sources of light, they're going to interfere with one another, and that's why you get some noise, which you cannot account for when you do the convolution. But if we find a way to find our PSF and apply it to our image, we might get a better resolution in Z. That's the idea behind why we do the convolution. Any questions? I know I went fast, but that's the... I do. I see something in chat, but I don't think that's... Okay, good. So again, recap. So we're going to pick our images, our final images. We're going to use the PSF that we acquired, that we know that we can describe it. And then we're going to run some algorithms, which are multiple of, to obtain our object. So what are these algorithms that people have defined? So there are many types of algorithms that people use. The most commonly used in biology is the Lucy Richardson one, which we will use in our plugin in Fiji. But now there are also wavelet algorithms and very fancy physics and mathematics going on, always on this topic, to better improve your signals. And I put a paper that you can actually read about, the latest fast iterative shrinkage thresholding algorithm, which is quite nice. But the idea is, and let me just show you the paper. Oops, many things. So this is our original image. If I apply a blur or a filter on it, and now I want to basically recapitulate this original image, I can run these thresholding algorithms. And the idea is that once you do several iterations of this algorithm of deconvolving this blurred image, you can get kind of close to the original file. So if I zoom in on this guy, it's not perfect, but it's much better than what we originally had, which is this guy over here.
So again, there's always noise when you acquire images in the microscope, right? So you're not going to get the perfect object, but you're going to at least improve the resolution or the filtered image that you get out of the images that you're acquiring in the microscope. So without further ado, I'm going to skip now to Fiji. So I'm going to close the theoretical part. I'm going to close this data set. And before we go, so for those of you that have been following the tutorials, I hope you are familiar with Fiji. For those who have not, let's just do a quick recap. So this is the user interface. It seems very simple, just a little bar with many buttons, but it's extremely powerful. One of the things that you can actually do. So Fiji per se doesn't have a deconvolution filter or any function for that. So we're gonna have to download the plugin that people devise in Switzerland that does this for us. There are other commercial solutions which are very, very good, like Huygens software. It's really the top notch deconvolution software for deconvolution, but that costs money. And I mean, you can also do some nice things in open source. Nothing in chat, right? So before we continue, let's just go, let me show you how you can put these plugins. So we're gonna go to help. We're gonna go to update. This basically is gonna run, it's gonna check the different repositories all over the world for updates of the common plugins. I'm just waiting. So you go to help, and then you go to update. And you're gonna find this window at the end. So I'm gonna wait a bit for people over here to catch up. What did you get? But the window is still open, or just restart Fiji then? Yeah, restart Fiji. So now we're gonna go to manage update sites. So you see on the bottom left area, there's a button called manage update sites. And there we're gonna download the plugins, the repositories of these guys from Switzerland that developed this plugin. That's pretty much the idea. But since we're here, I'd like you guys to download also some interesting things. So download bar, B-A-R, so just check bar. Then check the BIG EPFL, which is the one that we are mostly interested in. I know you guys don't use Latin America, but in case you guys want to try some interesting things, also download bioformats, that's also very cool. Quidge, we can ignore Quidge, don't do that. Then I want you to download IBMP CNRS. IBMP CNRS, just check that box. Then also the IGPB plugins. I know there's a lot of stuff, but I just want you guys to have the nicest things. IJPB, okay? And if my memory serves me right, that's pretty much, there's some cool things here, but not really for you guys. No PT biop, sim check also not, tissue analyzer track.
I just want to tell you what I'm working with.
Sure.
I'm working with microstructure for solidification. So I'm just looking for dendrites, arming space, all this stuff. So if I should download any library of this.
There is something interesting for you, but I think that's already on the default Fiji. We can talk about that later after the session. So okay, we have everything downloaded. So we checked all the boxes that I told you to check, right? So now we can close. And you're probably gonna have a list of things to do. I don't have it because I already have them. But you're gonna have like a list of files that you have to update. So now apply those changes. I want you to do the full update.
I was just gonna put it in what the plugins are right now.
So
okay.
BAR.
I'll type that BAR. Okay.
BIG PFL. Bioformats. That's just for opening files, different files. Then I want the IBMP CNRS. I don't think people use OpenCV, so we can skip that. IJPB plugins. And I think that's pretty much it. Okay, so Some magic happened. We don't know exactly what, but some things were installed, and now let's actually see the fruits of our labor. So a cool thing about Fiji is they can just go on this search bar here, and you can type anything you want. He's going to find you the routine or the macro or the plugin that you're interested in. So you can type in the convolution. Ignore the console that always shows up. That's absolutely normal. And we're going to go for the convolution lab 2 launch. And you should get something like this at the end.
I didn't see it.
So if you go here, type in the convolution recon or whatever. Pick up the convolution lab 2 launch.
I can't see any lab.
Yeah.
Oh, yes, yes. Yes, just a second. So go to this web page. So if you go to chat, you can see here the wikipfl.ch, the convolution lab 2. This is going to take you to this page. So download the jar file, the deconvolution lab 2 jar file. He's always going to say that. You got to trust the Swiss. You got to trust the Swiss. You got all of the file? You got the deconvolution lab 2 file? So let's do a bit. Yeah? So now we're going to show you the inner organs of Fiji. So. No, do not open it. I want you to drag and drop it, but I want to show you where you have to drag and drop it. So go to your Fiji folder where you installed it. So in my case, it's located in C. I'm going to my Fiji app, and then I'm going to go to my plugins, and I'm going to drag and drop the jar file that we just downloaded into that folder. That's all you have to do. Drag and drop the jar file into the Fiji folder, which is under the plugins folder of the Fiji app.
Just drop it in plugins?
Drop in plugins, that's it. And now we have to close Fiji and restart it. Couple of minor technical issues and we should be good to go. Okay. And now if you click on, you should find it. Please tell me you find it.
Good to go.
Good to go? Sorry about that. Launch. Okay, but so this is the plugin we're gonna be using, but we haven't seen the data sets, right? Let's look at the data sets first. You downloaded the beats file, right? The before, remember that the files, those folders that we downloaded? So I want you to extract those files and drag and drop them into your Fiji, just the folder of the beat. And once this import image sequence opens, you just say, okay.
I drag and drop into Fiji.
On top of the bar. It's as simple as that.
Not the whole bunch, just the beat.
Just a beat, just a beat. We're gonna start one by one. Okay. So you should have a black window.
I think everyone sees the black window.
So now you might be thinking, well, there's nothing in there. So he's just wasting our time. But if you notice in the bottom part, there's like a play button. And if you scroll with this button, you start seeing that there's an object in there. So again, this is just a Z stack. Z volume, a volume acquisition at different Z planes of our beads. Okay. You see it? So if you play around this scroll bar in the bottom, you can see your data set. So we have, for those of you that have, I don't know if you guys were in the previous sessions, but if you look in the top of the window, you have the amount of slices. We have 256 slices, 256 images. Each image doesn't have a metadata, but it's 256 pixels by 256 pixels. And they're all 16-bit, and the whole size of the file is 32 megabytes, okay? So this is how our beat in the microscope looks like. They might be looking, oh, but this doesn't look very sharp. I mean, you see that there's always like this halo. It doesn't look very, very sharp. So one thing, cool thing that we can do, and I'm sure to show you to people that are here in the audience, I think people I hope can also do it if they want to follow. If you go to stacks, so if you go to image, stacks, and you go for, I'm not in stacks. If you go to orthogonal views, and I just put it like this, you're gonna see that this opens up your XZ profile and your YZ profile. You see? And as you can see, this is basically cutting the cake. Imagine I have a volume, right? And I'm cutting the cake with my knife, and I'm now looking at it from the side. And if I look along this this big axis here, and I look it on the side, it's gonna look something like this, which is our typical flying squirrel that we see there. So although this should be a sphere, you see that it's a bit elliptical still and not very sharp, okay? Excuse me. Okay, so this is our data set, our final image that we took in the microscope.
This one, if you click like that.
So if you, let's say, use your mouse and click on any area of the original file, see? And now, if I put this a bit up, because my screen is not big enough. So this is if I follow this line, but I'm actually looking at the whole Z or whole volume at once, it looks something like this. Mm-hmm. This is if I'm following this line.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. And on the other side, okay? So it's a volume, right? Yeah. So we're looking at the volume in the orthogonal views. So this is a quite cool feature where you can do if you wanna show something moving over time, or if you wanna show something, you can do something like this. So let's close the projections. Now that we see how our object looks like, let's be a bit smaller. So if you go to your keyboard and you press the down button, you can zoom in or up. So I'm gonna make it small now. And now let's open our PSF beat. And again, follow the same instructions, just go okay. So this is a theoretical PSF, a point spread function, meaning this is, again, supposedly an image that was taken with the sub-diffraction limited system. And you see these patterns. I mean, so we never see this in when you go to the microscope and you do a proper PSF. This is a theoretical PSF that the team at Switzerland developed to make our deconvolution look a bit nicer, okay? So this is our theoretical PSF. This is how our light should behave once it goes to the objective. And now what we're gonna do with the software is we're gonna go to our deconvolution lab, which we opened before. And I'm gonna say that I wanna look into my image. So the way to do it is very simple. We can also drag and drop, I think. So if we go to beep, I can just drag and drop it there. And if I go to my PSF, I can now drag and drop it. Just remove the previous one. So now the software knows that this is my data set, which is our image, right? And this is my theoretical PSF, how the point spread function of this microscope looks like, how my objective interacts with the light and how it represents a sub-diffraction object, okay? Okay, so now let's see the power of this software. The cool thing about the software is that if you click now on the algorithm, and so if you click on, after algorithm, you click on that point, and then you go to this drop-down menu, you see all the different deconvolution methods that are available. And I mean all that the software knows of. I'm sure there are pretty much many more being developed, but again, this is your playground now. And as I said before in my presentation, what people mostly use in biology or in, not just biology, but also material science and stuff, we always use the Richardson-Lucy algorithm, which is an iterative algorithm. Basically, the idea behind the Lucy Richardson is that if I go back to my presentation, we're going to see what's the most likelihood estimate for my object, which is determined by this UT plus. And I'm going to apply a filter on the iterative basis. And as I'm getting closer and closer to that theoretical best result, then I stop. So in this case, we're going to start with 10 iterations, but you can increase this to 100, 200, how many you want. One thing that you have to be aware of, if you deconvolve too much, you're going to start also getting artifacts. on your image, which makes total sense, right? I'm applying filters on an iterative basis. And that's something that the software here doesn't do, because, for example, in Huygens, which is the commercial software that I was mentioning before, you can apply a quality improvement. So he can see, okay, if this image improves by 0.1%, we can still keep going. Once it stops improving at 0.1, he's going to stop the iteration. Here we're going to apply a typical set of number of iterations, and we can start with 10. You guys can try different numbers if you want. And then the only thing that you have to do is run or launch. I think launch. So when you launch, it opens a menu, because you can do this in batch. So it opens this menu when you launch, and then you can run. And you're going to see here there's a bar which is showing you the number of iterations and how fast it's going.
Okay, good. So again, depending on your CPU, on your processor, on your amount of RAM, it might take a bit longer or faster.
I think mine is already done, but I just wait a bit for you guys. Again, this is computational intensive, right? There's a lot of stuff going on, but you can see how theoretically easy this is, right? You just pick your favorite algorithm, put the specifications, and in the end, you obtain a data set that looks like that. Let's just wait for you guys. You might be thinking this isn't very different, but it is different. That's why beads are a bit boring. There's nothing really exciting. Let me just see if I do it or not. Yep.
So
when
you
say
what is?
So a bead, usually it's basically what it implies. It's just a bead that manufacturers produce with different sizes. And PPE. You can also have glass beads, which are very expensive, because you can imagine how to manufacture beads with always the same size it can be. But it can be anything. And what the important thing is that they actually are fluorescent. So we know exactly what's the fluorophore that's in there, and you can actually excite it properly. Now, think of it in terms of, this is the bead, which is the simplest case for the convolution. But let's think of an object. Like, let's say when we go for the C. elegans, which is an embryo, the idea that you actually apply antibodies on your structure, on your proteins. And these antibodies, they're going to react differently with one another and with the light. And what you have to do there to actually get a proper PSF is actually to establish single stainings on the same tissue with the same fluorophore that you're going to use when you have the multiple fluorophores, and then extract how bead there behaves. So you basically put these beads, which are the same fluorophore, in that tissue. We image it through the whole tissue. We acquire this theoretical PSF. And then once we have this ground truth of how my objective behaves with light, I'm going to apply it to my final data set with all the things combined. And that gives you an improvement in the Z resolution of your objects. How's it going, you guys? Is it processed or?
70%.
Again, there's no race here. It's just
just
different computers. Yeah. I did 12. Ah, you're ambitious. Okay, that's fine. So what am I doing? Everyone else, can I proceed or should I wait a bit more?
Okay, 90.
I can wait. It's 90. I can wait. I just want to respect you guys' time. We're almost done. So what I'm going to do now is actually ask you to go through the different data sets. And here I'm actually using the orthogonal just to make a quick overview of how it looks like. So this is my original file, my original bead. Yeah. This is deconvolved one.
And if I apply the same thing that we did before, and let me just move this a bit to the left. You see that here I'm getting a bit less of those X's before, and I'm getting a bit more concentrated in the center. Again, this is the most boring data set that you can ever find. There's nothing really significant happening there. But if you zoom in on your objects, on your initial file, you see that now we don't have those different halos that we saw before. It's a bit sharper than we had before. So I can only imagine if I keep iterating more and more, I'll get closer and closer and closer to the objects, to the ground truth. Okay. Now, I had planned to run a different algorithm just to show you the differences that can happen. So I put the FIST, which is the fast iterative shrinkage thresholding algorithm on the application. And you can see here that there are different parameters. There's still the number of iterations. There's a lot of physics that I can confess I don't master at all, but you can read that paper that I put in there. And you can play with the different wavelets with a different step of the gamma and everything to get the final result. Because of this, because of time, I'll rather skip this part. I'll let you guys play with this. I give you the tools to actually explore these functions. And I actually like to go now onto the C. elegans dataset, which is a bit more interesting, at least. I'm a biologist, so I always like more biology stuff. So I'm going to close the different images. And what I'm going to do now, because we saw how easy this is, I'm just going to drag and drop, for example, which one was, let me actually open the different data sets so we can see how they look like. We can pick the one that we find the most interesting. So this is a C. elegans embryo. So this is a worm embryo with different proteins that were labeled with it. So as you can see, this protein here is very fuzzy, but it's very punctate. I hope you can appreciate the punctate structures in there. I'm gonna, that bit doesn't really, it's not really interesting, but just there. Again, I hope back at home people are still following. I take that as a yes. At least Sam hasn't interrupted me, so I assume that everything is still okay. So I'm going through the different data sets and looking at the different channels. And for those of you that have followed before our sessions, we can now do something like this. We can go to image, color, merge channels. And I'm going to say that my red channel is the Psi3, so the C. elegans Psi3. My green channel is the FITSI, and my blue channel is the DAPI. If you're a blue DAPI person, it's up to you. And now I have my all three fluorophores combined. And this is how this embryo looks like, okay? So, yeah, Fiji is very cool. So we can go one by one. So again, this is how my DAPI looks like. So you can see that we have our nuclei very well labeled in there, but there's this fuzziness, right? This fuzziness we observe here in the background, which should not be there, right? DAPI is not cytoplasmic. There's nothing really in the cytoplasm. So usually what you would like to have basically would be to have only these little objects, like here very highlighted, and remove this blur. I would say you can do also always some filtering, some normal Gaussian blur, something like that, but let's apply some deconvolution to this. If I look into my different channel, my channel number 2, for example, which is our FITSI, we can see that we have like, these are microtubules probably. We see like the asters and like the extensions of these microtubules. And again, this fuzziness that we see in the background, which tells me that this was acquired probably the white field microscope along with the confocal. But that's something that, for those of you that are interested in light microscopy, we can discuss afterwards. And then we have like the red channel, which is a Psi3, which I'm gonna try to zoom a bit more so you guys can see it. There are some punctae there, but because of the fuzziness of everything, you see there are some punctae here, some signal, which is very scrambled. So this is probably like some mitochondria, some very structure in the cells, which are very punctated. But as you can see, because of this fuzziness or this blurriness, I don't see it very well. So I would say my target for the convolution would be the Psi3 channel. If you disagree, you can try the other channels, it's up to you. So now what we can do is, as we did before, I'm gonna go to my—
First, you then color and then merge channel.
Yes.
Okay.
Oh, you're still there? Sorry about that.
No, just following.
Okay. Again, you can get the color that you want. So if I want to put my red channel in this channel number 1 in a different LET, I can just like go yellow or whatever you want, whatever you prefer. You can, again, Fiji is, you can do, the world is your oyster. You can do many, many things there. Now, I know that my target is going to be the Psi 3. So I know that my image should be the Psi 3. So I'm going to drag and drop it into my folder as we did before. There we go. I'm going to remove the bead because I'm not going to use the bead anymore. And just for curiosity, let's see how what the PSF that the website provided looks like. So if I open the PSF in the Psi 3 channel, and this is again something that they did theoretically, it's not actually something that they could acquire. This is how a bead, a solid reflection bead in Psi 3 would look like. So now we're going to apply this pattern to our object that we saw before, to our image itself, and we're going to deconvolve it. So again, I'm going to select the PSF from the Psi 3 that was acquired hopefully in the same embryo with the bead. Okay, and now again, I'm lazy, so I'm going to go for the Richardson-Lucy. Sorry, feel free to try any other deconvolved solution method that you can think of. And when I run it, now it's going to take some time because this is a much bigger file set. It's a chunkier file, but hopefully we can see something at the end. I personally prefer to run with the launch because that gives you the little window that shows you the progress bar. But if you don't care about that, you can also just click on the run directly. So we did the first iteration and I'm running out of power, which is fantastic. You mind?
Thanks.
Oh, shoot, but. PG, if you're interested, you can go to edit options and go to memory and threads. So in my case, I have 16 gigabytes of memory. So I can then put 12 gigabytes dedicated for Fiji processing. So I can still have 4 gigabytes for Windows and all the other stuff. So depending on how much RAM you have in yours, which if you tell me, I can
check it.
Probably not a lot. If it takes that long, not a lot. So you can actually put a higher number. So usually by default, Fiji goes for a very conservative number. So you don't crash or Windows doesn't crash. Mm-hmm. I always tend to push it a bit higher. So in this case, I'm using 75% of my total RAM just for Fiji applications. Now in Calm, we have our workstations and I'm not trying to plug anything, which have many, many gigabytes of RAM. So you're more than welcome to use our workstations for this kind of analysis. If you need brain power and memory RAM power, you can use our workstations for that. Yes. So does deconvolution sharpen the image? Depends on your PSF. So again, deconvolution is mostly used for the Z resolution. So in XY, so you think of it like in terms of XY, you're not going to see major improvements in deconvolution. The interesting thing that deconvolution does is actually in the Z plane. So if you have a volume, a volumetric image, and you want to sharpen it, the resolution in the Z axis, you want to deconvolve it. Because it's going to make it sharper at the edges. So that's why instead of looking at the very nice elliptical sphere that we've seen before, it's going to be less elliptical. So in that regard, it's going to increase the resolution in Z, therefore sharpening it. Now, is it a sharpening filter? Not necessarily. Sometimes it doesn't work very well because you have either a bad PSF, which you don't acquire very well from the microscope, or it's just too noisy. Again, one ground truth for everything in science is garbage in, garbage out. So if your original data set is bad, no matter what algorithms or what mathematical procedures you can do, it's always going to be bad. It can be very hard to actually compensate for that. But again, if you just care about Z resolution and you have a good enough data set and you have the necessary controls, definitely try deconvolving. It could be a good help if you don't have fancy microscopes in your lab or available to you. Thankfully, we have those in Calm, so you can get to Calm. So again, I'm still on iteration number 4, so you can see this is actually very, very intensive. What I wanted to show is that actually now our speckles, our dots are going to be much more prominent because our blurriness, our background noise, our background signal is going to be much more reduced. But we just have to wait a bit.
So what is the just go merge?
No. So let me actually put this also both on the same grayscale. And now one thing that we can also do, and this is actually kind of cool, if you go to your search bar and you try synchronize windows. So we're gonna go to synchronize windows here. I'm gonna run that. So I'm gonna select, I wanna synchronize my file display of the RL, which is a file name over here, and my composite. So you see the cursor now? The cursor is gonna show up in both images. And now if I wanna compare the exact same C point, I can actually compare it. And as you can see, comparing the one on the left, which is our deconvolved image, to the one on the right, I start seeing the speckles a bit better. I hope you can appreciate
that. Yeah.
So background is a bit much more reduced. So you see here, there was like an imprint that was any better. And when I applied the bright PSF, it's starting to look much better. Now, I'm sure that if we go for more iterations, it's going to get even better. Usually people go for 40 with a quality increase of 0.1. Again, for the purposes of demonstration here, there's no need to go for that. But you see the power of that, right? The speckles that I could kind of interpret a bit before, I can now actually start seeing a bit sharper and more clearly. And if I now want to start thinking about quantifying, segmenting the objects and actually getting the size, the distribution, these are things that now we can start thinking about. Again, this is a very quick and dirty demonstration of the convolution. There's a lot more to be told, especially on the theoretical principles. Not an expert in that. I know how to use it. I know the basic concepts of it. I know when it makes sense to use it or not. I mean, again, if you have a very bad image, no matter what algorithm you run it through, it's always going to give you bad results. So make sure that your question and the data set that you want to use to answer that question is suitable. So always be critical when you have your data sets, see what can be improved, what cannot be improved. And again, if you have questions for light microscopy, you can always send me an email. I'll be happy to discuss your data with you guys. I think that's all I wanted to show you. I mean, today we was a bit different. So we went a bit outside of the normal patterns of Fiji. We had to download this plugin because the default Fiji doesn't come with this tool. But again, as you can see, and you probably saw when you were trying to download those different update sites, there are many people all around the world with different questions and different plugins made for specific questions. So sometimes what you're looking for example, your dendrites, there might be people already did something on filament tracking and everything like that. Yeah. So I can show you afterwards if you want. But the scientific community with Fiji and the open source power of it is always working on different things, different questions. And if you're a bit lost, ask around. There are forums where you can ask for information. People can also answer that. And also you're always welcome to send me an email and I can also try to guide you if I know the direction you have to follow. Finally, as a small shameless plug, there's gonna be a summer school in Calm. We're gonna organize it from the week of 19th of June to the 23rd of June, to the 23rd of June. We're going to be covering theoretical knowledge in the mornings about wide field, confocal, super resolution, basic microscopy like fluorescence, optics, all those interesting things that you need to know to understand a microscope. And the afternoons begin, going to be focused on practical applications. So we're going to be going to the microscopes that we have at Calm, and we're going to be playing with those systems. And on the last day, we're going to have a full day dedicated to image analysis. We're hopefully going to get some invited speakers from Switzerland. Not the people that developed this plugin, but people that actually work very closely with them. And hopefully it's gonna be a very nice image analysis session. There'll be more instructions, more information coming in the next weeks. So if you follow us on Twitter, follow us on Twitter. If you need more information, send me an email to com@macmaster.ca, and I'll be happy to point you out in the right direction. Our website is also gonna have information on that. So, but the dates are June 19th to June 23rd. Okay, if there are no questions from the audience, I think that's a good way to stop. It's
Friday, it's 4 o'clock.
I want to take much of the weekend.
All right. Well, thank you, everyone. I can switch. There we go. Thank you, everyone, for joining us for this session. We will update you for future sessions. And just a reminder that our YouTube channel has all the past sessions, so you're more than welcome to review things that we've done previously. And we'd be glad to hear any comments or questions, or if you have requests for topics, feel free to reach out. And we can take that in consideration moving forward. So thank you and have a great weekend, everybody.